Welcome, classic rock fans, to my first episode of Progressive Rock, A Brief History. The perfect accompaniment for a rainy Sunday afternoon, no doubt. This first episode is going to focus on 1966-1967, which will no doubt lay the foundations for future episodes to come. Anyway, I will say at this point, be sure to click like, subscribe, and check that bell so as not to miss any future episodes. And if you appreciate the work that goes into these reviews and you want to support me here at Classic Album Review, do check some of the links below this video for ways you can do just that. Check out the Amazon wishlist, become a Patreon. There's a fine body of work on there now. But anyway, enough of this flim-flam, let's get into it, shall we? I'm going to start this video with a quote. The New Rolling Stone Encyclopedia of Rock says, "Progressive rock denotes a form of music in which electric instruments and rock band formats are integrated with European classical motifs and orchestrations, typically forming extended, intricate, multi-sectional suites." But of course, it was much more than that. The term progressive rock was supposed to have been coined by melody maker journalist Chris Welch, who was a big fan of progressive jazz. And he saw those elements of experimentation beginning to emerge in popular music, notably bands like the Yardbirds and Hendrix and Cream. And the rest is history, as they say. "And on this rock I shall build my church." Progressive rock was an ambitious hybrid of musical form comprising of a number of different cultural tributaries, namely psychedelia, rock, jazz, folk and classical music. And for this video, I want to explore how all those streams merge into this one oceanic swell of progness. We are essentially discussing music that has, in part at least, its grounding in a Western symphonic tradition, something that irked the hell out of Lester Bangs, who felt that rock and roll should always draw from that African-American cultural idiom. With prog, there was a tendency to favour instrumental virtuosity over that more guttural, cathartic, emotional outing that we got with rock and roll. And it has to be said that such virtuosity was usually considered the hallmark of legitimate musicians, namely jazz and classical. Nonetheless, in the words of those wizened old sages, Thunderclap Newman, something was definitely in the air. And bands like the Beatles, the Beach Boys and the Birds were already incorporating elements of cultivated music into the vernacular of rock and pop. The scope and the ambition was certainly there. Progressive rock is often described as an offshoot of psychedelic or psychedelic rock, and there's no doubt that these counterculture musicians pushed the boundaries, but ultimately they were still operating within the paradigms of blues, folk, bluegrass and country, even those bands like Country Joe and the Fish, the Grateful Dead, Jefferson Airplane. But they were beginning to branch out and explore these often long improvisational jams, could be said to be almost the precursor to the extended form. Wikipedia informs us that prog is based on a fusion of styles, approaches and genres involving a continuous movement between formalism and eclecticism. What they mean by that is formalism is a preoccupation of established external compositional systems, i.e. the genres I've just mentioned. But what's interesting here is eclecticism is a preference towards style, synthesis, can't even say it, or integration. And that's what's happening here within the idiom of popular music in the late 60s. This exploration of musical form, however, it has to be said that often psychedelia would just descend into this splurge of vague formlessness, reverbed voices and lysergic meanderings. Take a listen to the first album by Ultimate Spinach to get what I'm talking about. Ultimate Spinach, by the way, were part of the Bosstown sound as a almost an oppositional faction to the San Francisco scene. From this late 60s awakening and this counterculture, one dismissed by Pete Townsend as a movement fueled by misplaced idealism and drug-fueled hope, as well as no doubt the proliferation of psychotropic substances and a general unbuttoning of the mores of the post-war generation. But nevertheless, we can see those prog tributaries beginning to emerge here. Begin to feed into something much bigger than itself, eventually expanding out into vast topographic oceans where many prog fans believe it all goes to sea. But the formless vagaries of psychedelia would eventually, especially in the UK, move towards sonic expansion rather than just mind-altering trajectories and the exploration of alternate states of consciousness. And bands like the Beatles and the Yardbirds are already experimenting with rock music by incorporating other interesting influences like Indian ragas, oriental melodies and Gregorian chants even, as well as elements of the avant-garde, all contributing to this vast experimental soup of sound. The authors of the book Beyond and Before Progressive Rock Since the 60s, Paul Hegarty and Martin Halliwell, identify bands like the Beatles, the Beach Boys, the Doors, Pretty Things, the Zombies, the Birds, the Grateful Dead and Pink Floyd as, quote, not merely as precursors of prog, but as central developments of progressiveness in its early days. Which is essentially what this video is about, isn't it? And all music also reinforces everything I've just said. Prog rock began to emerge after the British psychedelic scene in 1967. Specifically, a strain of classical symphonic rock led by the Nice, Procol Harum and the Moody Blues. We'll come on to those in a minute. Let's think about 1966. What a fine year for music that was. Saw the release of Blonde on Blonde, the inaugural Zappa album, Pet Sounds. But a little bit closer to home, the spires of Canterbury Cathedral had already seen the blossoming of the Wildflowers. And the Beach Boys were demonstrating that music studio was more than just a means of recording. It was, in fact, a treasure trove of possibilities for artists. And the Beatles, of course, would rip a page out of that specific book a year later. We also get the debut album from the aforementioned Frank Zappa and the Mothers, who were demonstrating the influence of composers like Varese and Stravinsky, incorporating elements of the avant-garde and music concrete, as well as professing a love for groupies. With this experimental sonic stew, peppered with biting social commentary, as well as lampooning popular music styles of the day, pretty progressive as far as I'm concerned. In fact, I read somewhere, and I can't remember where, that one commentator says that progressive rock began with Frank Zappa's The Duke of Prunes. Musicologist Walter Everett, in his book, The Beatles as Musicians, said that the Beatles' experimental timbres, rhythms, tonal structures and poetic texts on albums such as Revolver and Rubber Soul encouraged a legion of young bands that were to create progressive rock in the early 70s. I already mentioned how important the studio was as part of the creative process rather than just a means of recording. And if we're going down that road, of course, we have to doff our caps to Phil Spector, whose drive towards the ornamentation of popular music also plays a part in our story. But then we get this intellectual gravitas that popular music begins to have, largely in thanks to people like Bob Dylan. I mean, Bob Dylan used biblical and literary elements in the popular vernacular of rock, partly inspired, of course, by his interest in his fascination with the Surrealists and the French Symbolists, whose influence were all over that holy trinity of Bobness, namely Highway 61, bringing it all back home, and the epic Blonde on Blonde. And thanks in part to his Bobness, popular music was beginning to be given a seat at the table of high culture. That is before Dylan's motorcycle accident and he re-emerges as some sepia-toned parabolist and country crooner. And Pet Sounds is also artistically very important for demonstrating to us what was possible for the long player, a nail that the Beatles would hit even harder the following year. And not Good Vibrations, dubbed a pocket symphony by Derek Taylor, the band's publicist, displaying, and I'm quoting, an eclectic array of exotic instruments and several disjunctive key and modal shifts. My word, there was so much going on in music at this time. And we have to, of course, sort of be aware of the rise of the London underground scene, you know, clubs like the UFO, Middle Earth, where you'd get bands like Pink Floyd and the Soft Machine, experimenting with sound textures and long form, largely improvisational forays, championed, of course, by John Peel. The band 123, later The Clouds, were also influential on our later prog luminaries. But let's head for the southeast of England, shall we, the Canterbury scene. You know, this was one of those tributaries of progness that described, in fact, as a subset of prog bands, but definitely feeds into our prog story, like Krautrock, in fact, but that's for a later episode. The Canterbury sound originating from Canterbury, strangely enough, and, of course, the Wildflowers, were often characterised by things like the use of wind instruments, complex chord changes and long improvisations. But there was something whimsical about the Canterbury scene, I think. Something of the Kenneth Graham about them. Its improvisational style, blended elements of jazz, rock and psychedelia were certainly all there, but nevertheless, according to the Progressive Rock Forum, the real essence of the Canterbury sound is the tension between complicated harmonies, extended improvisations, and the sincere desire to write catchy pop songs. I believe in the very best Canterbury scene music, the very silly and musically serious are often juxtaposed in an amusing and rather endearing way. 1967, the Beatles released the Sgt. Pepper album, that loose concept album, that phantasmagoria of sound that explores sound collages, as well as strange, eerie explorations of childhood and Victoriana, a bygone age. But this is a very important musical statement. It helps establish bands as artists and advertises the possibilities of what could be done with the album format. Hence was being born the album culture. The Beatles had already been exploring with chamber music, the Baroque, the avant-garde, so there's a lot of stuff already going on with their music. A lot of experimental, dare I say, progressive stuff going on there. But with Sgt. Pepper, and you could argue albums like Freak Out and Pet Sounds before it, artists began to view the possibilities of, they began to conceive of albums as extended, conceptual, interconnected works, rather than just collections of disconnected songs. In fact, Bill Bruford said that Sgt. Pepper transformed both musicians' ideas of what was possible and audiences' ideas of what was acceptable in music. Without the Beatles, I think it's fair to assume there would not have been progressive rock. Meanwhile, in the Midlands, this R&B band, perhaps influenced by the whole Merseybeat thing going on, named the Moody Blues, were undergoing a seismic change as well. The recruitment of Justin Hayward with softer, more ethereal tones and Mike Pinder's explorations with the Mellotron were pushing the band in more melodic, more orchestral direction. Of course, they were commissioned to create a rock version of Dvorak's New World Symphony, which mutated into Days of Future Past, a kind of concept album that focuses on the story of a day unfolding. To some progressive rock fans and music fans, they see the grandiose and symphonic ambitions of this album as being, perhaps could be considered the first prog album, first progressive rock album. However, in my opinion, and feel free to disagree with me, of course, this is a pop rock album with classical trimmings and instrumentation. It's an original and beautifully crafted album, there's no doubt about that, and a signpost on the way to progressive rock. But merely that, in my opinion. But there's lots of other things going on at this time, things that would later play an essential part in our narrative. Bands like Simon Dupree and The Big Sound, even the pre-Elton years, that would later merge into Gentle Giant around about 1970. The Sin were already established, of course, formerly Mabel Greer's Toy Shop. So the markers were all there in many respects. But by 1968, something else happened that was a vital part of our story. A dynamic band featuring Keith Emerson, Lee Jackson, David O'List and Ian Haig stepped out from the shadow of P.P. Arnold, started burning the American flag to their own rendition of Leonard Bernstein's America in an incendiary performance. Things were definitely heating up. But I will continue this in the next part of our story, Progressive Rock, A History Of. Anyway, that's episode one. Stay tuned for episode two. I'd like to thank you all for watching. I'd like to thank you if you've managed to get to the end of this video without switching off. Be sure to click like, subscribe, of course, but more importantly, be safe, be healthy, enjoy the summer, what there is of it, and more importantly, please do keep listening.